It's time to learn about inverse functions. First, let's briefly review what a function is. A function is an association that assigns each element of a set called the domain to an element of a set called the range. We can represent a function with a diagram like this one, where the domain contains the elements a, b, c, and d, and the range contains the elements w, x, y, and z. Defining a function then just means drawing arrows from the left to the right, like this. Now we have a function that maps A to W, B to Y, C to Z, and D to X. If you're not comfortable with functions, you should stop now to review them, and then come back to this video. Now I'm going to show you what the inverse of this function is. Let's move F to the left, and on the right, we'll get F inverse by reversing the directions of the arrows. That's it. We denote F inverse with an F and a negative 1 as a superscript. The original function mapped elements in the left column of letters to elements in the right column, so the inverse goes from the right column to the left column. This means that the domain and range have been interchanged, so the domain of F is the range of F inverse, and the range of F is the domain of F inverse. This leads us to the intuitive definition of an inverse function. Namely, the inverse of a function undoes the action of the original function. Let's look at those diagrams again. You can see, for example, that F maps B to Y. Well, then F inverse maps Y back to B. So if we start at B, then F sends us to Y, and F inverse sends us back to B. Likewise, if we start at Y, then F inverse sends us to B, and F sends us back to Y. So we always end up back where we started. Now let's make the intuitive definition formal. For a function F with domain A and range B, the inverse of f is a function with domain b and range a, such that f inverse of f of x is x, for every x in a, the domain of f, and such that f of f inverse of y is y, for every y in b, the domain of f inverse. Let's look at an example. Let's let f of x equal 3x minus 7. Then f inverse is x plus 7 all over 3. To verify this, we use the definition to see that f inverse of f of x is 3x minus 7 plus 7 all over 3, which simplifies to x. The stuff in parentheses comes from the x in f inverse of x, which we replace with the formula for f of x. Let's also verify the second condition, where we see that f of f inverse of x is 3 times the quantity x plus 7 over 3 minus 7, which also simplifies to x. Here, the stuff in parentheses comes from the x in f of x, which we replace with the formula for f inverse of x. Let's look at another example. Here, f of x equals x cubed, and f inverse is x to the 1/3. We'll verify this as we did in the previous example, and we get x cubed to the 1/3, which is x, and x to the 1/3 quantity cubed, which is also x. So this is how to verify that two given functions are inverses of each other. The next thing is to learn how to find an inverse. It's a three-step process. Start with y equals f of x, then interchange x and y to get x equals f of y, and finally solve for y in terms of x. Let's look at an example involving one of the functions that we've already seen. So with f of x equal to 3x minus 7, we start with y equals 3x minus 7, then interchange x and y to get x equals 3y minus 7, and finally solve for y in the previous equation to get y equals the quantity x plus 7 over 3, which gives us f inverse. If you want to see more examples, there's an example video with just that. So we just saw the process for finding inverse functions. You might wonder whether this method always works, in other words, whether there's always an inverse. We'll talk about that in the next video.